Welcome to The VT Show, a weekly online series featuring Vineyard artists sharing conversation, insight, and performance. Please welcome Douglas Abel and Sarah Stern.
Hi, and welcome to the VT Show. I'm Sarah Stern.
And I'm Doug Abel.
And we are the Vineyard Theater's artistic directors. And that was the amazing singer-songwriter Laura Nyro in one of her rare television appearances singing Save the Country. We are so excited today to reunite some of the cast, the amazing cast, of the Vineyard's award-winning musical ELI’S COMIN, which featured the words and music of Laura Nyro. We have the incredible powerhouse performers, Judy Kuhn, Mandy Gonzalez, and Anika Noni Rose here with us today. Together, we are going to revisit Laura's work and her legacy and the show. And we expect to be joined by a special guest a bit later on too. If you have questions, please feel free to write them in the comments section. We'll do a Q&A at the end with all of our guests. Before we bring them out here, let's talk a little bit about the origin of ELI’S COMIN. It starts with the man that I'm sharing this screen with in this virtual space, Douglas Abel. Doug, ELI’S COMIN was such a passion project for you. Can you talk a little bit about your relationship to Laura Nyro's music and the origins of this show?
Sure. Well, believe it or not, it began when I was 11 years old, when the ELI and the 13th Confession album came out. And I remember as a child hearing these strange and wonderful sounds coming out of the stereo in our living room one Sunday morning. And I went in to investigate it. And there was my older sister and a bunch of her friends in leotards doing this mad interpretive dance to one of the songs from ELI. I think it was Lonely Women. And I was just fascinated by the power of this extraordinary, strange, beautiful music and this exquisite voice coming out of the speakers and its sort of hypnotic effect on these young women. And it just made an indelible, it was an indelible moment for me. And from that moment on, I just became truly what I would say is an obsessed fan of Laura Nyro. I collected her albums, I listened to them incessantly, and I really have to say that she was the most important artist, at least in my own development as a young person and as a young theater artist as well. What was so amazing about her work, which we'll get into because it was so revolutionary and exciting, was when her original group of albums first came out sort of in rapid fire, ELI and New York Tenderberry and Christmas and the Beads of Sweat, she had a lot of fans and people very passionate about the beauty and joy and danger of this music. But simultaneously, her songs were being covered by some of the biggest, most popular artists of the day. I remember one day listening to the ELI album and then having my driver's ed class. And we were in the car for about an hour, and song after song on the AM radio were Laura Nyro hits. You know, Fifth Dimension doing Wedding Bell Blues, Blood, Sweat, and Tears doing And When I Die, the Fifth Dimension and other groups, Barbra Streisand, Stony End. It was just incredible that her work was existing both in a genuinely popular way with the masses in America by famous artists, and then the real thing, the pure Laura experience. And early on, when we started the Vineyard, I just dreamed of a way we could somehow bring the magic of that work to the stage, because for me, listening to a Laura Nyro album, and I think for many of her fans, was an almost like religious experience. You would sit there in the dark and it was like a curtain opened up on this interior landscape of this amazing woman. And it was like this dangerous, wonderful place with captains and devils and angels and girls named Emmy and a kind of beautiful, serene, and yet scary place sometimes. And it was just so theatrical. And I thought, wow, it'd be amazing if we could try to make that happen on stage and introduce her to a new generation. So I tried for about 10 years. From the early days of the Vineyard, Sarah, I constantly, by that time, Laura Nyro had sort of left the spotlight. And she was living very happily in a quieter way in Connecticut and still writing and performing. And I remember I reached out to her representative, her attorney, many times, and they were like, thank you for your interest, but you know, she's really not interested in, you know, doing a Broadway show. That's what they thought we were trying to do, which it wasn't. And so I kept trying, but at a certain point, I thought, okay, this is probably not fated to be. And then 1997 came, and sadly, she passed away very young, and it was just a terrible thing. And I remember about a year or two later, and I think you were around the Vineyard, starting out at the Vineyard at that time with me. Mm-hmm. I cut out an article with a beautiful photo of her. For some reason, I don't know, it was like 1999 or something, and I put it up on the wall in my little cubicle. And I kid you not, that very day, my phone rang, and this man called me named Bruce Buchel, a wonderful writer and journalist, and he was a friend of ours and mutual acquaintance. And he jumped in and he said, do you know who Laura Nyro is? And I was staring at her on my wall. And I said, yeah. And he said, well, I've gotten the rights to her musical songbook from her estate to develop a theater piece. And I'm new to this, and I'm wondering if you could consult with me and we can have a chat about it. And of course, right away, I was like, I'm not just going to consult with you. We are going to do this. And I remember running through the office of the Vineyard, and you were new to us then. You were not as familiar with the work. And I ran to you and to Jen Garvey Blackwell, who was our producing director at the time. And I said, listen to these albums. We're doing the show, whether you like it or not. We're doing the show. I was so excited about it. And I was thrilled that the young staff also connected with her material. And that's how it began. We brought Diane Paulison, brilliant director, to direct it and co-conceive it with Bruce. Everybody was on the same page about not wanting to do a sort of standard book musical or like a sort of a jukebox show, but seemed to agree with my original hope, which was to kind of create something special and different that would explore emotionally and spiritually the journey of a group of women through Laura's music, and went through the usual process of readings and workshops. We got the greatest cast, I think, in musical history. We just love them. Brilliant arrangements by Deidre Murray, brilliant design team, Skip Mercier and Jane Cox. And we opened, and it was a joyful experience. I think it was one of the longest running shows in the Vineyard's history. Actually, it was quite a long run, and it capped off with 5 Obie Awards, which is thrilling. And mostly we just were so thrilled that we were introducing her work to a new audience that wasn't that familiar with it and embraced it thoroughly. So it was a beautiful and a highlight, at least, of my career.
Mine too, actually. And that was my introduction to Laura Nyro, was you running through the office and bringing her albums around. And, you know, it's extraordinary music. And before we bring out our guest to continue this conversation and talk more about it, we actually have a short clip from the Vineyard's production of ELI’S COMIN that we can share. 19 years ago, when we did this show, CBS Sunday Morning did a segment on Laura and on ELI’S COMIN, and we have a little clip from that to play.
There's an off-Broadway musical called ELI’S COMIN, which is made up of Laura's songs.
Whoa, you better hide your heart.
On stage, 4 women take the audience on the same journey Laura's music took.
Can you celebrate? Can you picnic?
From wide-eyed romantic innocence through heartbreak, obsession, and finally a kind of serene wisdom.
In addition to Judy and Mandy and Anika sounding so stirring in that clip, that first voice you heard was the beautiful singer Renelle Bay, who wasn't able to be with us today. Let's bring on Judy and Mandy and Anika. Hello.
Hello.
Blast from the past seeing that clip.
Yeah, amazing. It was amazing.
How are you? Where are you?
I'm home in New York City.
I'm home in New Jersey.
I'm home and chilling in my living room and just hearing that, and it just put such a big smile on my face. That song was so amazing. And when I think about the final performance of that song, I will never, ever forget it. It was like, it was a spiritual situation in that theater, the energy. And I remember all four of us were looking at each other at the end of it like, is that what just happened? Is that what you were singing today? Oh, that's what you were gonna do? It was amazing. It was such a gift.
Well, I have to say, singing with the three of you was one of the most profound musical experiences I've ever had. I mean, it was just incredible that, like, the way that we all made music together was really just a gift.
It really was. It was in every night was there was something a little different. I'll say, because she's not here due to run now, but it always made it that much more interesting and special. And, you know, it was a musical journey that I don't think any of us will forget.
Yeah.
So how familiar were you all with Laura Nyro's music before this show?
Well, I'm a little older than these other two women.
Oh, really?
And I did grow up with her, you know, sort of in my milieu, but I wasn't as obsessed with her as Doug was.
Sorry.
No, but thanks to the show, I became really obsessed with her. And I thought, how did I, you know, I had other musical obsessions when I was young. And I don't know how, I think I wasn't ready for her when I was young.
Mm-hmm. My mom loved Laura Nyro. So I was always aware of who she was and the Fifth Dimension and their recordings, but my mother was, I mean, it was her thing. So when this came about, did I know all of the songs? No, but several of them felt very familiar for me because I know I had heard them. And she was over the moon when she found out about the show, and it just felt, because our songs are so earthy, they always felt comfortable and natural. And let me not make that sound like that meant easy, because it's not easy music. But it is music that comes from your feet, from your gut, from your womb. And it was, it felt very familiar. And with these voices, the blend that we had, it just felt like a natural thing and a natural place to be.
Yeah, I think for me, it was my dad was really into Three Dog Night growing up. So I remember, I grew up in LA. I remember just rolling down the window and listening to ELI’S COMIN. So when I first heard the music that we were gonna sing, it was the same thing. Like, a lot of things felt very familiar and very, I guess, connected with what those times with my dad, you know? So it felt just so good.
Doug mentioned Deirdre Murray's extraordinary orchestrations for mm-hmm. this. When you were learning the music for this, were you listening to Laura at all and her renditions of these songs, or were you really learning it from Deirdre's orchestrations? Do you remember?
I think it was a little bit of both for me, because at that time there was no like iTunes. It was kind of like what you could find at Colony Records. And so I was doing research like that, but really just listening to Deirdre and trying to figure out those harmonies. That was like enough work.
And a shout out to our musical director too, Joe Rubinstein, who was
really yes. Great.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting that you guys are talking about how you harmonize together, because as you probably know, Laura on her albums usually cut tracks where she created her own three or four part harmony with her own voice on her song. And I know when she was a little girl and a teenager, she used to go in the subway with her friends because the sound was so good. And they would do sort of doo-wop songs and do sort of girl group harmony. So it was something that was so thrilling for us when it all came together, was hearing all of your voices are magnificent and very different from each other, but you did have this amazing blend and you just captured sort of the various corners of her musical personality too. It was just perfect.
She had such a huge range too. I mean, vocally, stylistically, she was all over the place. I mean, it was kind of extraordinary what she did.
Yeah.
Well, she was influenced.
Like she had multiple personalities, but without it being a disorder. Like it was just, it expressed itself through all of those songs. And I feel like a lot of artists are not allowed to be multiplicitous anymore. You know what I mean? People want to hear one thing, one style, whatever. Maybe after a few years, you can put out an album that has something different, but they want to have something that when you hear it, that you know immediately that's whomever it is.
Right.
And there are very few artists that do something else like that now. I don't think because there aren't people who are able to, but I don't think that it is as appreciated maybe as it was then.
Sarah and I were talking about, you know, looking at her biography, you know, she grew up in a house full of music and her mother would play opera and Leontine Price and Debussy. And her father was a professional jazz trumpeter. And she was also obsessed with the music of her growing up years, from soul music to Burt Bacharach. She loved it all. And that's what's so cool, I think, about the musical range and the ambition in the music, which some of the songs sound like Broadway show tunes. Some of them are much more jazz or R&B inflected. I mean, she just took from every part of the, I think, of the American musical experience and made it her own.
I think that the one thing that she did consistently, which is probably why she drew in so many people from so many different walks of life, is that she was a storyteller. So in each song, there was a full and completed story. You can hear a song on the radio now that's a verse and a half for 3 minutes. This woman had a whole journey that happened in her songs. And I think music was more like that, maybe probably until disco or towards the end of disco. But she was really amazing in that ability to storytell.
She was also a poet. I mean, some of the language of her lyrics, it's like, it's, you know, what does New York Tenderberry mean? I don't know. It means what you want it to mean. You know, it's so, she's really an extraordinary lyricist.
Mm-hmm. She created words. She turned the word Surrey into a verb. Can you Surrey? It was really amazing because she just created magic around language as well. It was really special.
Yeah, absolutely true.
I know that we have so much ground we want to cover in conversation today, but I actually wonder if it would be great to hear a little bit of Laura now at this stage of things. Judy, I know we have some possibility of you sharing a song with us.
I just have to get my technology going here. Okay. I think. All right. Wish me luck.
Got this.
I was born from love, and my poor mother worked the mines. I was raised on the good book Jesus, till I read between the lines. Now I don't believe I want to see the morning. Going down the stony end, I never wanted to go down the stony end. Mama, let me start all over. Cradle me, Mama, cradle me again. I can still remember him with love light in his eyes, but the light flickered out and parted as the sun began to rise. Now I don't believe I want to see the morning. Going down the stony end, I never wanted to go down the stony end. Mama, let me start all over. Cradle me, Mama, cradle me again. Never mind the forecast, cause the sky has lost control, and the fury and the broken thunder come to match my raging soul. No, I don't believe I want to see the morning. Going down the stony end, I never wanted to go down the stony end. Mama, let me start all over. Cradle me, Mama, cradle me. Going down the stony end, I never wanted to go down the stony end. Mama, let me start all over. Cradle me, Mama, cradle me. Cradle me, Mama, cradle me. Cradle me, Mama, cradle me.
So beautiful.
Thank you.
Amazing to hear that.
What?
I was singing my harmonies. I remember them.
You know, as Doug talked about, you know, earlier, the show really had much more of an emotional through line than it did a literal kind of book of a musical. And I wonder what that was like for all of you as actors to play that way and to approach it, the material in that way.
Oh, it's a good understanding.
Sorry, Anika.
No, I said it took me a little while to sort of understand it, but if once we started putting it all together, I kind of did. I don't know, Anika, what were you saying?
I think I sort of said the same thing. I said at first it was frustrating. I think we were all really frustrated because we're used to, we're actors, we're vocalists, we're used to telling stories. And when you're thinking of doing a show, you're imagining that there's going to be a story, an arc for your character. But I think that once we realized that it was more going to be an emotional journey, then the point was, like, we had sort of vague character names, and I think we all sort of made up journeys for our characters through the songs that we were singing. So fortunately, her songs are so emotional and the journey is so strong that we were able to use that and make a real thing and a connect. And we had each other on stage. So, you know, if we were in a spot where we were confused, we'd be like, looking at each other like, let's just grab each other right now, until we really got to a place where it was, I think, a fine-tuned journey that was sort of cobbled together, but held together with the glue of her songs.
We also developed these relationships with each other, with our characters, whatever they were, that was, I don't even know if I could articulate what they were, but they, as we went on, it seemed very clear to me what my relationship with each one of you was.
And did you feel that the songs assisted you in that because of the songs that you had been given to sing? Or that you put that through the songs?
Yeah, because it sort of, what material we each had sort of made sense in that way. Like we each had a role, we each had a function in the piece. I don't even know if I could articulate it, but I felt it somehow.
No, but also I feel like, and Mandy, what do you think? I felt like New York City was a character in the piece.
Sure. It was my first drive to New York, you know, so I felt like, you know, that feeling, and I had come from the job that I had before, like I was a backup singer with Bette Midler, and so I love singing and harmony and singing together, and so that felt so, like, familiar to me and how I grew up, but, you know, I was just like, yeah, this is great, and it's all gonna work. And character, like, great, like, I'll figure it out. Like, I'm the young girl, okay. Like, I was just so willing to just do anything. Like, I was so happy to be there and in the room that it felt like I didn't question maybe as much as they did, like, about different things, because I just was like, oh yeah, okay. And Diane would give a direction, and I go, okay, that's what I'll do. And then within the music, I think I found who I was in the show, you know? And that's when, like, the real work started, you know? But it wasn't until we started the show and I started to see, like, all the numbers together. And because we were always on stage together, I mean, I think we had one maybe time off the stage, because even if we weren't singing, we were there. So it was like, well, who am I with Wilson up in the rafters, like, who am I, you know? So it was, for me, like, one of the best experiences, you know. Now I've been in this business now 20 years in New York, and it's like still one of the best experiences I've ever had.
Let's give a little shout out to Wilson, actually, Wilson Haradea, who was the one, a man on stage. He never sang. He was a kind of silent, sometimes dancing presence, I think representing the various male figures, you know, the male spirit, sometimes the devil.
well, and male devil.
It's funny that you mentioned Bette Midler, who was a big Laura Nyro fan, and she actually tributed her when Laura was quite finally inducted to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Mm. And I wish I had the speech in front of me, because it was so beautiful how she attributed her, but she said something that I remember that was just so sweet and right. She said, Laura had this way with words and music. She could take a trip to the grocery store and make it this weird, fantastic journey on a carpet ride. You know, it was like she sometimes those very abstract ideas in her songs that we all thought were about something deep, or actually she was writing about her cat. she found sort of the mythology and stuff, you know.
But she's also sort of lived her life that way. I remember when I did a Laura Nyro tribute at Lincoln Center as part of the American Songbook series, and I read a ton of stuff about her. And there was one story about when she was making the New York Tenderberry album, the studio was on 52nd Street, and she lived on the park at 79th and Central Park West. And she made the studio get her to work every day in a horse and carriage. That's how she went to work.
Why not?
That's how she got involved. She lived her life in this kind of fantastical, mythological sort of way, which I thought
was great. You know, she also, a lot of the musicians who worked with her, I was reading about this last night, you know, she didn't write out music. You know, she was very musical, but she didn't write that way. And all of the studio musicians would comment that, like, her way of working with the arranger, she would speak in other terms. She'd say she want more purple from the violin, or she'd want the cello to sound like the chair in her living room. She had these very abstract ideas, but people understood what she was saying. You know, she just had this rare ability to communicate. And one other thing that I remember that I just want to throw in is that she, if you collected her albums, she was very involved also with the design of them. They were very beautifully done with amazing photos. And the thing that I remember most clearly from my youth was her Eli and the 13th Confession album. She actually designed, there was a sort of lilac colored insert of the lyrics. And she fought with Columbia Records. She wanted to have it scented. So she actually got them to find this perfect perfume that was a lilac perfume, and all 300,000 albums were scented with it. And so you would get the album and you could sniff it. And I remember having that album after 10 years, there was still that scent. Who would ever do that? That was her, you know?
Details, that's awesome.
Anika, some of the songs that you sang in the show had such exquisite poetry in them. And I wonder, I'm thinking particularly of The Confession, which is so amazing.
It really is. And I loved The Confession so much because it was such, it started out so sweet and it was such an epic rock out, which was never something that I was considered for if you were, you know, thinking about music, and yet something that I've always longed to do, that I love to do. And this song, when you read the lyrics, it's, you know, you're like, oh, I mean, okay, but you know that she's talking about this lover, but she's turned it into, as Doug was talking about when Bette was saying that she would do a shopping trip. She's actually talking about a shopping trip, but it's not to the grocery store. So it starts with super sun, sugar cupping in the morning. Do your shopping, baby. Oh, love my love thing. Super right inside my love thing. You may disappear, but you'll be back, I swear. Would you love to love me, baby? I would love to love you, baby, now. Would you love to love me, baby? I would love to love you, baby, now, baby, now. And then she goes into this thing later. She's like, mama, it's my pain. So she goes from talking about this lover and having this lover basically steal a little sugar in the morning. And then she goes into this mother thing at the end, and the ultimate mother thing, where she talks about virginity and how we came into this world and women's, what does she say? I keep hearing mother crying. I keep hearing daddy through his grave. Little girl of all the daughters, you were born a woman, not a slave. Oh, I hate my winsome lover. Tell him I've had others at my breast. But by then it's, oh, I hate my winsome lover. Tell him I've had others at my breast. But tell him he has held my heart. And only now am I a virgin. I confess. I confess. So it's religious and it's sexual and it's spiritual and it's some of the most beautiful, beautiful poetry of how we love each other and leave each other and hurt each other. And yet she feels not until she had found real love did she feel the purity that people associate with virginity. She's amazing. She's amazing.
I mean, there are many themes that run through her songs, and the mother is another. I mean, that in Stony End, which I just sang, she talks about her mother or a mother. She talks about mother as being the earth. I mean, you know, she's, yeah, deep.
But I think that that was something that was really magical to her, the ability of women to bring life. Mm-hmm. The fact that women are life and really is the reason why people are constantly trying to squelch womanhood somewhere, somehow, because they're afraid of the magic that comes with womanhood and the amount of life that we possess. And I feel like she possessed more than so many. Like she died too young and very young, and yet she lived more than people who live to their 80s.
Yeah.
Mm. True. You talk about New York as a character in the show, and ELI’S COMIN, which it really was. And she was born and raised in New York. Her family, this is one of the most memorable parts of this whole experience, her family coming to see this show, her father.
Yeah.
Was really, yeah. It was so beautiful. I'm sure you guys were aware of it, that, you know, they were all a little timid at first, but then when they started to hear that the show was good, you know, there's all of her cousins, her lovely brother, Jan, who is a brilliant musician himself, and looks exactly like Laura. It was kind of, and he was very, very kind. And he was like, he came right up to us afterwards and said, she would have loved this. And her lovely son, Gil. But I think we all have to remember the most amazing member of the Nyro family, which was Laura's dad, Lou.
Who was
in his 80s then, and he was originally a jazz musician, but then made his living as a piano tuner for all of the musical people on the Upper West Side. And I remember he came to our first preview, and he really connected with it. And from then on in, I think he was at every single performance, every single night. It was incredible. And he would sort of shyly after the show walk up to people and say, I'm Laura's father. And it was just so sweet.
So beautiful.
I remember, though, we used to hug him on the way out because he was there. And we would just give him a big old hug, and he was so sweet and so happy. And it was, I don't know, it was such a gift to give him, someone who lost a child they loved deeply, that kind of gift, that kind of rebirth.
He had lost his wife at a young age, as well as Laura. So he was a grieving person and a very, very kind person. And I really think the show, I'm not trying to toot our own horn, but I think it gave him a great second wind. And he was with us the whole way. So the whole family was really wonderful to us.
Mandy, I know you have a song from the show that you might be up for singing today. Are you up for it?
Yeah, I have a song. Hold on, let's see if this all works. We'll do our best. Hold on. Let's see.
Does the song need any kind of singing?
Yeah, this is my first song, so let's see how it goes. Wiz and a scholar too. Mama, open up the room lock. Sip, sip, I'm going to the moon dock. He gives to me buckles of shingles, of a cockleshell, your hand chasing. Coke and tuna, boots and roses from Russia. Now I live and die and rise with my captain. Mama, I told my mama, say go, meet me, Captain Sailor Sapphire, darling, I'll be there. Don't you know? Whoa, whoa, meet me, Captain Sailor Sapphire, darling, I'll be there. And don't you know? And don't you know? Meet me, Captain Sailor Sapphire. La 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 la. Ooh, I love you. Love you, I do. Wiz and a scholar too. Mama, I'm an anchor in your glow now. Sip, sip, even as I go now. He gives to me buckles of shingles and a jangle from a conch. Oh, love chase. Early bloomers made of earth and love.
Dear mama, I told my mama, be happy. Meet me, Captain St. Lucifer, darling, I'll be there. Don't you know? Oh, oh, meet me, Captain St. Lucifer, darling, I'll be there. And don't you know? Oh, gutters and stacks is where I come from. Buckles on the poverty drum. Oh, my love trumpet soul. Tell Gabriel to tell the captain. Thank you, baby. You're my baby now.
That beautiful voice. Mandy, I remember you would be on stage, like you were like a little willow, and you have a huge mane of hair. You were like our little lion, and you would open that mouth, and that roar would come up out of that mouth, and we were like, what?
I'm telling you, this was like, honestly, like seeing you guys, and this is just like such a highlight. It was such a highlight of my life, you know? Like, I got this job from an open call. I moved to New York, and I've been there for, I guess, 6 months. I went to, you know, I had to work, so I packed groceries for rich people in the mornings, and then I coached, so made tips. And I would audition during the day, and I waited 3 hours in line to audition for this show.
Wow.
And to sing my 16 bars, and I was, you know, I was picked. It happened for me, you know. Cindy Tullin and Doug Abel, you guys, like, gave me my first chance. And I'll never forget that. And it was, like, honestly, one of my highlights, my time here in New York.
Mandy, I'll never forget, because I was at that open call as well, which was for two things. One that was amazing was, like, a ton of people showed up. We had no idea. I felt like 1,000 people showed up. And there were all these young musicians. And what thrilled me was a lot of them, so many of them would like say, check this out. And they'd open up their shirt and they had a tattoo of Laura Nyro on their chest or one of the people were, and we realized, wow, across all these generations, so many people loved her and wanted to sing about her and for her. And there you were, you know, and that happened. You know, I just want to throw in one other thing listening, if I may, to Captain St. Lucifer, which you sang so beautifully. And it's such an amazing song. It sort of sums up a lot of what we're talking about with a man named St. Lucifer. Hello. That's really an interesting mix of ideas and metaphors. But musically, it's such an exciting and interesting song, the way she would change meters and change rhythm suddenly. And I remember when her work first started happening, people like Leonard Bernstein and Stephen Sondheim started going, wow, this is like the most amazing composing talent coming out of pop music. And I think people were flipping out because there were no rules. She just took so many chances musically as well as lyrically. I think I don't know if we have it, there's an amazing photo of her with Sondheim when they were hanging, there they are.
Wow.
Hanging out together in his townhouse. I think that's 1969. And she just bridged so many worlds in that way.
Now, there is an extraordinary woman who was instrumental to the creation of this show. And she is our secret surprise guest today. So I would love to bring her into this conversation. Diane Paulus, the director of ELI’S COMIN, is here with us.
Hi. Hi, everybody. Oh my goodness. It's so amazing to see you all. And I've been listening and talk about like a trip down memory lane. Oh my goodness. I mean, starting with you, Doug, your passion for Laura Nyro. I was remembering, you know, Mandy, you were talking about the Vineyard giving you your first big break. And I think I used to like usher at the Vineyard. And I was like, maybe someday I'll maybe I'll get to direct here. Like, it was just this unattainable, you know, like idea of like a goal, you know. And then I remember you called me, Doug, initially, and you sent me a play, and I remember reading it, and it was a play, and I didn't quite connect to it, and I thought, oh God, like, I'm a young director, I can't call Doug Abel back and tell him that, like, I don't want to do this play, but something in my heart said, like, oh, you know, I don't think it's for me, and I thought, okay, he'll never call me again, and then you called me back, and you're like, I think I have a project for you. And you said, do you know Laura Nyro? And I was an example of someone who I didn't know her music. So like you and your passion for her introduced her artistry and her soul. And then, you know, gosh, it's like she influenced so many people in the music world. Like, I feel like Laura Nyro paved the way. And just listening to all of you sing her music, and I'm overwhelmed by how far out the show was. Like, when I think back on it, it was like wild, you know, what we were doing and the songs and the fact that it sort of didn't have a traditional structure and we were living inside it. And I was having these flashes to each one of you and the staging these songs, you know, like Anika, the confession, you like took over the stage. And Judy, weren't you sitting in a chair for Stony Inn? Wasn't it like a,
yes,
it was like a, almost like a group therapy session, and almost like a cappella out of time, yeah, like way, way down, like downright house, right? We had chairs set up on the floor, right?
Yeah.
And
it was
then
emotional, that song in the context of the show. I mean, I think it's an emotional song anyway, but.
Oh yeah. It was like raw, like raw, like you were like creating it as you sang it. And then I really related to Anika's memory of you, Mandy, because yeah, there you were, the young one coming on, and like, boom, like that voice came out with that epic song. I don't know. I'm full of gratitude. I'm full of gratitude for Laura Nyro and for her courage and for breaking all the rules. Yeah,
just broke every rule. I think every female singer songwriter in some way owes a their legacy to her. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
This whole line of singer songwriters that maybe don't even know that she's part of their legacy.
Exactly. Know? Exactly.
Can I show this picture that I just found online? Oops. Mm-hmm. This is when we won the Obie, and I just found it, and I'm wondering if it'll look, you can see it.
Oh my God.
Oh, yay.
We're so blown away.
We didn't know. We were just like, oh, you guys were invited to go. I was like, wait. I got the outfit. I did my nails. It was like,
it was Mandy. It was your first show. It was only my second show in New York City.
Right.
That was the last thing I expected was going to come of this. But I feel like this show was so New York in so many ways. What? It was the introduction to the city that, you know, when you hear the song on Broadway, they see the neon lights are bright on Broadway. And it's everybody's dream to come and do theater in New York and like win in some way. Mm-hmm. And this was such a win in so many ways for us, even just being able to share the stage together. Because I think that I think of New York as a city is an ensemble. Mm-hmm. Everything in the city makes New York what it is. And I feel like all of us together on stage, there was so much love and joy that even when we were like frustrated or hungry or didn't get it, Judy, you were sick the last show we did. Cause I remember, Anna had been sick and you were up all night and you came in like,
I remember that.
By the time we got on stage, you were blowing. Like, there was just such a joy
It was such a gift. It was such a gift. I will never, ever forget it. Yeah, I'll never forget it.
It's lovely to hear, Diane. One of the reasons why, when you said you had never heard of Laura Nyro, that was when I knew I wanted you to work on it, because I think with the whole company that, you know, we didn't want it to be a kind of standard tribute. We wanted to be, you know, to really give an opportunity to a bunch of young artists to really interpret this beautiful material. And, you know, it's interesting, right up, you know, we won the Obie at the end. We had a really nice long run, as I recall.
It was extended, I think, right?
It was sold out. And ironically, we played till the end of like July of 2001. And just at the point when we wanted to like, you know, move it to Broadway or whatever, a thing called 9/11 happened a month later, if you recall. And how ironic that this artist we're exploring, who was all about love and compassion and praising the human spirit, and that's what happened to New York right after. And how amazing, I mean, not to draw an analogy, but here we are at this other kind of difficult time. And I listen to her music now when I walk my dog, and it's so healing and so pure. And I really, I hope that our show, in a small way, and I hope that this kind of event will lead people who don't know her work to really experience it, because it's out there. It's very accessible.
I love that you call it pure, because she was so not afraid, like Anika said, of sexuality and, you know, so many things. But there was like a purity, because she was unfiltered. It was like unmediated. You know, it was just raw, like, you know, raw music making, raw poetry. Judy, you're so right. She was like a poet. I mean, the lyrics of her songs. I also had a flash of like having all the lyrics printed out, because that was basically our script, and just studying them, like reading them, like, what does this mean? Like trying to analyze all, like, you know, what's the stony end, you know, like what are, you know, just all the theories. And it was like Shakespeare. Every line could have, you know, seven different meanings depending on, you know, how you were reading it.
Sarah, I see that we have a lot of comments.
We are getting some comments and questions, and so maybe we'll take one of them. Let's see. Well, Rich B on YouTube is asking, have you ever considered releasing or streaming a cast album or video of the show? Funny you mention that, Rich.
That's an idea.
About that.
We still wanted to do a cast album, remember?
No, yes.
Okay. How long? Just that little thing called money that we...
You never know.
I think there might be a recording somewhere.
Hmm. No, there might be a hidden live recording. I don't know. Who knows?
We certainly would not condone a secret bootleg of this show, but if it got out there, we would not be responsible.
This is wrong all day. So amazing.
I'd like to mention Sam Rudy said hello on YouTube. Sam was a wonderful friend of the Vineyard Theater. He had such a passion. He loved you guys so much. Mm-hmm. And he said that he loves hearing these beautiful women reminiscing about this great show all from afar while he's fixing dinner. Hello, hello, hello.
We love you, Sam. You know, as you talk about the continued relevance of these songs and how much they speak to our current moment, you know, part of that too is the evolution, I think, that she underwent in her music. Some those early songs that are so much about, well, they continue to bring all the themes together that you're talking about, but there really was, it seemed like, an evolution, you know, in her life too, as she maybe found more contentment and more peace as she got older.
She like the early albums, she was this passionate, questioning young woman in New York. The albums have that kind of passion and sometimes torture and joy. And as we know, she gave up on fame. It was very brave of her, because she was very popular, very young, and in her early 20s. And she moved, I think, to Massachusetts. She had a child. She got married briefly and then raised her son and different relationships. And she did go back to performing. One of the joys of my life when I was in college was actually, she was on tour with her comeback album, Smile, and she performed at my school. And I waited like 4 hours so I could sit in the front row. And so that's spirit. What I remember is she was very solemn at the piano. She really wasn't like a performer who dealt with the audience a lot. It was almost like she put herself in this hypnotic state. And it was a very kind of religious experience for her as well as the audience. It was very special. And when she moved to Connecticut in later years, and she did still write, but it's interesting, as Sarah's alluding, I feel like she moved on almost, she stopped writing about herself in a way. She got very involved in issues, feminism, animal rights, ecology. I mean, she was really very passionate about saving the planet and—
Yeah, like ahead of her time.
I feel like she kind of, in a way, like a lot of people from her stormy early days, started looking more at the challenges and suffering of others besides herself. I don't know if that's true or not, but it seems that way.
This isn't a question. Oh,
talk about her, like, that she was channeling something, you know? In her music, when she performed this, she was channeling some spirit or something. It was kind of crazy. Sorry, Sarah.
No, it felt that way. That was, I just was gonna share a comment, not a question from Facebook, but Ian on Facebook, this will go back to our reminiscing. He wrote, I paid my first ever visit to New York in April, May, 2001. As a big Laura Nyro fan from England, I was incredulous to discover that the show was on in the city while I was visiting. I went to see it. It was fantastic. Thanks to everyone involved in the production. I still remember it fondly. A beautiful piece of musical theater. Cheers, everybody. Mm. Thanks, Ian. We're so glad you got to see it.
I'm so glad you read that, because what was amazing to me in the show is the people that traveled to come and see it. We had like two or three people from Philly who came five or six times to that show. A guy named Nick Roby, and I can't remember the woman who was with him, but she was a major musician. She's since passed away. And they came like five times. We had people coming from all over to come and see this show. But I think that Laura represented for so many people love. She was just love to people. And that is a tribute to her purity and her honesty, because you really can't represent love without a deep and pure honesty. And I think that ran through everything that she did.
Yeah. Hey folks, I had an idea. I just felt like, would it be nice for a minute or two just to listen to Laura? Have a little quick song that I would say it would be appropriate if we did a little invisible toast to her, because it involves wine, I think, if you know what song we're talking about. So we're just gonna play a little clip of it for a second, and so that we can just listen to Laura herself.
Let's go.
Amazing. Like the way she plays with rhythm and time, like just even that song that's like chugging along, she just like stretches it and pulls it. And she was a mad genius.
Yes, she was.
Mad genius.
She was.
And, you know, don't you feel, folks, as well, that sometimes, like, I'll listen to her, especially where she's just at the piano, and it's so current. It doesn't sound like music written from another era. I, as Sarah put it, I think there are a lot of young women who are singer-songwriters who may not even realize how profoundly she's influenced them, but she's influenced a lot of them, and a lot of artists through the years. And I think it's just that mad abandon and danger and excitement, and the way she didn't give a damn what anyone thought. She just lived her life the way she lived it.
Yeah.
It feels like she's an artist that people will keep coming back to and keep rediscovering over and over again. She'll just always stay current, it feels like.
I think so too.
We're almost out of time. Are there any burning last reflections? I know we could keep talking and talking and reminiscing about the show, about her work for so long.
I want to say that we had the best band. Our band was so fired.
Thank you for bringing up the band.
Yes, so true.
So amazing.
Amazing group of musicians. And they, the other thing, aside from being great musicians, they also loved playing the show. They loved being on stage with us. They really loved it. Part of the ensemble. And it gave the show this particular kind of energy that was just fantastic.
There was always a wonderful moment. You know, the show was so passionate and intense. And we didn't just do all of her like famous hits, you know, a lot of like her introspective material, but we get to the curtain call, as I remember, and after the final bow, you guys went into this rousing edition of Laura's biggest hit, Wedding Bell Blues, and I would always remember the whole audience would like, oh, yes, because they've been waiting for that song all night, and it just made them so happy, and it was, you know, because it's a very happy song, and I've rarely just seen, at least in our theater, so much joy every night from the audience and such a sense of connection with artists and musicians on stage. It was incredible. And it was really a really special moment in time for us. And I'm really grateful to all of you for making that happen.
Mm. And we're grateful to all of you for being here today and coming back to talk about it and revisit it. It brings so much joy to see all your faces and to hear you sing this beautiful music and live and on the recordings. And just thank you all so much
for reuniting us.
I know. Like, it's so
thank
good.
You for choosing us.
We may
thank
have to
you
do
for
it.
Choosing. I feel like you gave us friendships that are going to last so much longer than, unfortunately, the show did. But I remember being in that dressing room, and it was a tight dressing room, and it was four women, and the band was behind a curtain. And it's very easy to get tired of people in that situation. And we, and Judy's daughter was in the dressing room with us a lot of the time. She was like seven. It was joyous. There was never a moment where I was like, oh my God, somebody give this woman a cubicle. It was, we enjoyed each other so very much. It was such a gift. I'm just grateful. I'm thankful for you all. I think you're beautiful artists and beautiful people. And,
same.
There's a lot of love there.
Same. Yes. Same. It was an event.
It really was.
Here's to Ronell.
Here's to Ronell. Ronell Bay.
Here's to Ronell.
Thank you all so much for bringing that joy back here today and letting us revisit it. Truly, truly. Thank you. You all for being here with us today. Come back next week. We're going to have John Kander, Susan Stroman, and David Thompson here to talk about their decades-long collaboration. And before we send us all off today, or to send us all off, we're going to ride out with a very short clip of Laura Nyro singing And When I Die, the first song she wrote when she was 17. Followed by a short clip of our cast from ELI’S COMIN singing Wedding Bell Blues, which, as Doug mentioned, was one of her biggest hits. So enjoy, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. Stay safe.
Thank you.
And when I die, when I'm gone, there'll be one child born in a world to carry.
Come on, Bill. Come on and marry me, Bill.
Thank you for tuning in to The VT Show, brought to you live every Tuesday at 5 p.m. If you would like to view previous episodes, you can find them on Facebook and YouTube. See you next week.